Father, we love you, and you are the great I am. You are the creator. You are God, and we worship you. We praise you for your goodness and your grace to us. And on this Palm Sunday, as we prepare our hearts to celebrate what happened at the cross, but also what happened on Easter Sunday. And we meditate on your goodness and your grace and your provision for us for the forgiveness of sins so that we could have eternal life. All we have to say, Lord, is thank you. We are grateful and we praise you, the great I am. We ask that you be glorified for the remainder of our time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning. And I have the distinct privilege of continuing to worship with you, but also to introduce our guest speaker today, Johnny Quinn, a hometown Olympian. How many of you are familiar with Johnny Quinn? All right, a bunch of you. And he's our guest speaker today to bring an encouraging message to you. Now, Johnny is a hometown guy. He went to McKinney High School where he played football. And his senior year there, he led the state in receptions for 5A football. He came in second, I think it was, for touchdowns in 5A that year. So he's obviously a successful football player and then went on to UNT, University of North Texas, where when he left there, he was their all-time leading receiver. All-time leading receiver. And then was eventually inducted into the UNT's Hall of Fame. And then he also went into the NFL, where you began to see a storyline develop with Johnny at this point. He went to all cold places, Buffalo, Green Bay, and Canada. And then after that, he became one of only three NFL players to play both in the NFL and compete in the Winter Olympic Games. So that was Herschel Walker, Jeremy Bloom, and now Johnny Quinn. Now, he's most famous for a picture I'm probably going to show you right now. Y'all remember that door that Johnny busted through in the Sochi Olympics 2 years ago in Russia when they tried to lock him in his restroom so he couldn't go compete? And he busted through that. He'll tell you more about that in a little bit. So today, Johnny is a motivational speaker and encourager as he goes around the country sharing his story of encouragement and what it means to have grit before greatness, as the pastor's been talking to us about, and how to push through and bust through the walls of your life and barriers of your life. So we're excited to have him today. He's also founder of AthleteWatch.com, which is an online leadership development course for student athletes who need to find scholarships. And that's also a part of his testimony. He has with him today his wife, Amanda, and some family, his mom and his dad and mother-in-law, I believe. Why don't you, anybody that's with Johnny, y'all stand up so we can just welcome you guys to Cottonwood Creek. Y'all, let's welcome them. Thank y'all for being here. Johnny and Amanda will be in the atrium afterwards to greet you if you'd like to visit with them. And they also have a special gift for you, and he'll tell you more about that at the end of his message for everyone here. So be sure not to leave without that special gift. Well, if you will, help me do this. Let's give a Cottonwood Creek welcome to Johnny Quinn.
Thanks, Scott. Thank you, Scott. All right, we got the Olympic music going. I like this. This is good. Well, hey, my name is Johnny Quinn, and I am a United States Olympian in the sport of bobsled. Do we know what bobsled is? Have you seen it, right? There's not a lot of Texas bobsledders, I can tell you that. That's an oxymoron. When you look up that word in the dictionary, you see Texas bobsledder, because those two words, they don't go together. And so I'll share kind of more on how I got to this part, because I can assure you, when you live in Texas, you don't think about bobsledding for the United States of America. And so I'll walk you through my journey. But I had a chance to meet your pastor a couple months ago and begin to get to know John Mark, and what a great guy he is. And so he caught me up to speed, and I've been watching online on this series that you're in, Grit Before Greatness, as you guys are studying the book of Exodus. And I am honored and humbled to share my story with you guys today. You know, my wife and I, we've been married for 687 days, and so we are newlyweds. And We traveled from the other side of 121. We live in McKinney, Texas, if you know where that is. So we are your next door neighbors. When I was in the Olympics last year over in Sochi, Russia, you saw the picture that Scott put up. I got stuck in my bathroom. I was taking a shower. I was in the Olympic Village, and I couldn't get out of my bathroom. And so I had to break down this bathroom door. And so I get out. I take a picture, and I put it on social media. And oh my goodness, things went crazy. And so I brought a short video from the Olympics about this whole door thing. Let's watch this clip.
Good morning, America!
Olympic bobsledder Johnny Quinn.
Johnny Quinn doing that to the door.
American bobsledder Johnny Quinn.
Bobsledder Johnny Quinn.
Johnny Quinn, U.S. bobsledder.
Bobsledder Johnny Quinn is probably the first Olympian to deliver a breakthrough performance before ever competing. And it all started in a bathroom.
I just went to take a shower, and I get out to go check the door so I can go get a towel. And when I get there, it's locked.
Johnny Quinn tweeted this picture showing just how he broke out of a locked bathroom by punching the door.
That's called a Russian remodel. If I was strong enough, I would do that every time I left the room.
Now, this went viral at home on Twitter. So how many followers did you start with, and how many are you at now?
Started with around 2,500, 3,000. I'm now at 23,000. So picked up about 20,000 followers.
We double-checked to make sure that all the bathroom locks were working. In case Johnny Quinn tried to bust down some of these antique doors, we didn't want that to happen.
Getting into bobsled, Quinn was a talented college football player, went to training camp with the Bills and the Packers.
I knew what my end goal was, and experiencing the adversity early on, although it was tough, it didn't derail me on where I wanted to go.
Look at the shoulders. He's 6 feet 220. Obviously, a bathroom door couldn't hold him down in Sochi.
Oh, he's in the middle of the foot. Look at that, a tumble.
Then you're Johnny Quinn at this point, the guy who burst through a door. And then
the elevator.
You'd think the universe would cut Johnny some slack after he had to pull a jailbreak on his own bathroom. But just 2 days later, he was trapped again, tweeting, "No one is going to believe this, but we just got stuck in an elevator."
Are you now keeping yourself in safe environments? I mean, how are you making sure you don't get trapped again?
The Denton Police Department tweeted and asked if they could show him how a door really should be knocked down. So today he got to use different rams to test his skills.
Not just when he's swinging forward.
And look at this, Quinn though, locked up here, can't get the momentum.
Do we have any American Ninja Warrior fans in here? Anybody watch that? Yeah. You know, I really wanted to get to the warped wall, but who knew a swing set was going to be my demise? Hopefully next season I can go all the way, but breaking down a door in Russia truly opened the door to some opportunity. I had a chance to go to the White House, meet the president, even train with the SWAT team. They wanted to show me how to break down a door the right way with a battering ram. Although I don't know how many battering rams I'll be carrying with me to the restroom, but now I know the official way on how to break down a door. You know, coming back from the Olympics, it's been a fun journey. I've been given a unique platform to share my story. And growing up, I wanted to play in the NFL. That was my goal. And when you play football in Texas, you learn about the three F's early on in life. Let's take a look at them. Faith, family, and football. That's what we know in Texas, isn't that right? And so I learned this. And, you know, I grew up in church, and I made an authentic decision to accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior at a young age. It was authentic. And what you're going to see in my story today is this drift, and then God calling me back to Him, that His grace, His mercy is enough. You know, wanting to play in the NFL is a good idea, I guess, but not when you're 5'11 and 7'8", and that's what I am in height. They wouldn't even give me 6 foot. And so I knew at 18 years young, if I'm going to play in the NFL one day, I'm going to have to start outworking some people. And I found one scholarship offer to the University of North Texas in Denton, America. Got some Mean Green fans, I like it. 2 days before signing day. So talk about down to the wire. I just got in. And I remember stepping on this college campus as an undersized wide receiver. And we go into this college weight room, and my coach starts putting everybody in groups of three. He puts the quarterbacks together, puts the running backs together. And he gets to me, and I'm looking around the room for all the wide receivers, because I played receiver. I'm trying to size up my competition. And he gets to me, and he puts me with two linebackers. Now, if you don't know football, that's okay. A linebacker in college at the Division I level weighs 225 pounds. I weighed 175 pounds, a 50-pound difference. Talk about being overwhelmed. I was scared. My new weight room teammates were grown men. And I remember stepping in the weight room with my new teammates, and every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, they'd ask me this question. Every time we stepped in, they'd say, "Johnny, how much weight are we taking off for you?" Every time. They weren't being mean. They weren't being rude. They were being truthful. I was the weak guy in the group. And I didn't like it. I felt uncomfortable. I felt embarrassed. I just didn't like it. But I had a couple options. You see, when things get tough, and they do, when you're in the grit, and maybe you're in it today, you always have a couple options. And at this time, I had two options, and I go to my coach and I say, "Hey, you know, I play wide receiver. I want to go back with the other wide receivers. I mean, that's what's fair. Or I could trust in his leadership. I could trust he might know something that I don't know just yet." And I started to get stronger. And we stopped having to take off as much weight, thankfully. And by the time I left the University of North Texas, I set the bench press record, the power clean record, the incline press record, and to fast forward 10 years later, during Olympic qualifications, I became the first athlete to power clean over 400 pounds at the Olympic Training Center in Lake Placid, New York. And so I share this with you, not to talk about the numbers. There's some young cat training right now who will one day crush those numbers. But an understanding that when things get tough, and they do, when you're in the grit, I want you to know that there is a reward at the end. Oh, there is a reward that is so much greater than the struggle through the process. You know, I knew I couldn't do anything about my height in college, but it made logical sense to do something about my speed. And so I said, "Hey, maybe I should walk onto the track and field team." Now, if you don't know track, that's okay. Track's a whole new ball game. I mean, in football, you have a helmet, you've got 85, you know, of your teammates on the sideline. If you're not playing, I wore number 81, you could have the helmet on, kind of hide the 8. Nobody knows where you're at. But Track? Whoa, track. You're in a lane, all by yourself, no helmet, in a speed suit. If you're taking last place, everybody knows who's coming in last place. And my first 2 years running track, I took last place in the 100-meter dash and in the 200-meter dash. And I don't know what I was more embarrassed about, taking last place or Mondays. See, Mondays, we'd go into the locker room and coach would put the results up on the board. And Mondays are when my friends would show up. Mondays are when my colleagues would come to the office and they'd see the results at the bottom. Johnny Quinn, 200-meter dash at the bottom, Johnny Quinn. And I did not like that. I was very embarrassed for my friends to see that type of performance. But I had a couple options. I could go to my coach, the leadership of my life, and say, whoa, I signed a football scholarship. And it says I earn a degree and I compete on the football team. I mean, that's what I signed. I want to go back with the football guys. I mean, that's what's fair. Or I could trust in his vision. I could trust he might know something that I don't know just yet. And I started to get faster. And I stopped taking last place, thankfully. And when the NFL scouts came to the University of North Texas, I ran the fastest 40-yard dash time on the team at 4.42 seconds into fast forward 10 years later, during Olympic qualifications, I ran the second fastest 60-yard dash time on the United States Olympic team. And so I share this with you. The numbers are irrelevant, but an understanding that there are going to be some times that it gets tough. Maybe you're in it now, where you can't see past the next day. But I want you to know that there is a reward at the end. Oh, there is a reward that is so much greater than through what we call the messy medal. You know, as my college career started to come to an end and it was time to get ready for the NFL, things went very, very well. I was at North Texas at a very good time. We won 3 conference championships, and I was fortunate enough to leave as the school's all-time leading receiver. And let me tell you something, when you start interviewing NFL agents, it's a lot of fun. My family, we interviewed 8 different agencies. We found the right group that was right for my family, and seeing those numbers on a contract, everybody was getting excited. And so we wanted to see how many wide receivers are getting drafted every year. And so we looked at the previous 9 NFL draft classes, and somewhere between 28 and 32 wide receivers get drafted every single year in the NFL draft, and we felt good. See, because of all the receivers coming out, I was in the top 10 statistically in career receptions, career yards, career touchdowns. So if 28 to 32 are getting drafted, and my production says I'm in the top 10, well, hurry up draft day. Who's going to give me a chance to go after my dream? And when the NFL draft came, my senior year, 35 wide receivers were drafted, and I was not one of them. And so at that point, I was confused. Because I was told if you produce, you get rewarded. If you make the plays, you get rewarded. And that did not happen. And so I was confused on this process. Now, shortly after the draft, I had my first free agent contract come in with the Buffalo Bills. Do we have any Bills fans in here today? One, you brave soul. We had none in the last service. Tell you, only when we're in New York do we really have a lot of brave soul. I like that. Well, let me tell you, I'm 22 years old. I signed a 3-year contract for $1.2 million. I'm fired up to be in Buffalo, New York, if you're tracking with me. And I remember getting to Buffalo, getting all of my NFL gear to see my name in an NFL locker room. It was unbelievable. We get into practice with the Bills, day 3 of practice, torn hamstring. A torn hammy? You gotta be kidding me. Day 3 into my childhood dream coming true, a hamstring injury? I ran 4 years of Division I track and never had a hamstring injury. But day 3? Do we know what the NFL stands for? Not for long. And boy, they had me on a flight back to Texas so quick, I was out of there. Contract gone. But that was the first time somebody sat me down, right, looked me in the eyes, and said, Johnny, you're not good enough. We're not going to keep you around. We're not going to let you rehabilitate your hamstring. Today, we are cutting you. Contract gone. Now, maybe somebody said that behind my back before. I don't know. It's been behind my back. But to hear that, I didn't know how to process that. And so I'm back in Texas and training, and my agent finds a new team the next year with the Green Bay Packers. Do we have any Packer fans in here today? 1, 2, 3. Okay, we got a hand. 4, 5. Good. I like it. Well, let me tell you, I am fired up to be in Green Bay. I get to Green Bay when Brett Favre retired the first time. Can we get that? 23 years old, I signed another 3-year contract. This one's for $1.4 million. I'm fired up to be in Green Bay, Wisconsin. And I'm going to let you in on a secret. When you're trying to make an NFL roster as an undrafted free agent, you want the star quarterback throwing you the football. Aaron Rodgers was taking over as a starter. He's throwing me the ball in practice. I'm getting great film. I get selected as off-season performer of the week. We get into the preseason. I have my first NFL reception on Monday Night Football in historic Lambeau Field. It was unbelievable. Then 3 weeks later, they cut me and send me home. Johnny, we're not going to keep you around. We don't think you can help the team win. Today, we are cutting you. Contract gone. See, it was at this point that I realized, and my agent couldn't find a team in the NFL, so he sent me north to the Canadian Football League. Did you guys know they played football in Canada? I had no idea. I go to the Saskatchewan Rough Riders, and if we know our Canadian provinces, that's above Montana, North Dakota. And let me tell you something about Canada. If you haven't been to Canada, It is cold in Canada. But I have a chance. That's all you want. You just want a chance. Now, growing up in Texas, I was thinking NFL, not CFL. Do we know what CFL stands for? Come for less. And it was a lot less. But I have a chance. And that's what you want, an opportunity. And so I get to Saskatchewan, I make the team, I earn a starting spot on the roster, getting great film, right? It's only a matter of time until my agent gets me back in the NFL, right? Just on a little detour. We'll get back on track. I score my first professional football touchdown. It was unbelievable. And then 1 week later, I blow out my knee, torn ACL. So there I am on some random field in Canada, minus 29 degrees, a blown out knee, trying to figure out, what's going on? Why is it so tough? This isn't the way it's supposed to go. And so I had a conversation with the general manager. He calls me and he goes, Johnny, go back to Texas, rehabilitate your knee. Come back up here next year, re-earn a spot on the roster. I believe in you. So, whoa, I haven't heard that at the professional level, but thank you very much. So I go back to Texas, rehabilitate my knee. And if you've done an ACL before, you know someone who's maybe done an ACL, you know it takes 6 months, 9 months, sometimes a year recovery. I get medically cleared in 5.5 months, 2 weeks before training camp, 2 weeks before I get to continue to go after my dream. And then I get a phone call from the general manager. He says, Johnny, we are worried about your knee. Today we are cutting you. And so I'm grabbing my medical document, saying, well, no, I'm clear. I'm healthy. 6 months ago you said you believed it. Today we are cutting you. Contract gone. See, it was at this point that I realized that my football career, my big dream was over. And here's where I got confused. See, I'd watch TV. I'd scroll on Facebook or be on social media. I'd listen to the radio. And you know what I would see? I would see success after success after success. And my career has been an absolute train wreck. And so I was confused. See, it took losing it all to realize that I had an identity crisis. See, I'd put my worth into being a football player. And when that got taken away, I had an identity crisis. Somewhere along the way, I concluded that my value as a person was tied to my achievements as an athlete. If I was a good football player, then I mattered. If I wasn't, then I didn't. So getting cut was more than just getting cut. It was a direct assault on my identity. You know, at 22 years old, I became a professional football player. But by age 26, I'd been cut three times, lost $2.6 million, and blew out my knee. Talk about life hitting you in the face. It beat me down. In Matthew chapter 7, Jesus talks about building on a solid foundation. Anyone who listens to my teaching and follows it is wise, like a person who builds a house on solid rock. Though the rain comes in torrents and the floodwaters rise and the winds beat against that house, it won't collapse because it's built on bedrock. But anyone who hears my teaching and doesn't obey it is foolish, like a person who builds a house on sand. When the rains and floods come and the winds beat against that house, it will collapse with a mighty crash. Now, as I look back, if I would have played out my contracts and received $2.6 million at 24, 25, 26 years old, I feel fairly confident I wouldn't have gotten involved in organized crime, okay? I'm pretty smart. I wouldn't have done that. But what would have happened is I would have continued to build the mound, continue to pack the sand of self-righteousness, of look what I did. Look what I can accomplish. And that would have been just as deadly. And so I did what every Texas high school football player does. I started bobsledding for the United States of America. Right? Now, it was very interesting. Some things started to line up. My mom had a coworker that was a bobsledder in 2010. So I got in touch with him. My agent represented a bobsledder in 2002. So we started having a conversation. I said, are you talking about Cool Runnings, the Jamaican bobsled team? That's all I knew. Jamaica has a bobsled team. If you haven't seen this movie, you got to go get it. And I remember having this conversation with my agent. He goes, yeah, Johnny, there's been two people to play in the NFL and compete in the Winter Olympics. The first person to do it was a guy by the name of Herschel Walker. I said, oh, if Herschel did it, yeah, sign me up. How do we do this thing? And so I end up talking to this driver at the Olympic Training Center in Lake Placid, New York. We're having this conversation. He goes, Johnny, come up here to the Olympic Training Center in a couple months, push a bobsled around, right? See if you like it. I'm like, okay, but if my agent finds a football team, I'm out of here. True story. 1 month before I'm supposed to report to the Olympic Training Center, I get a phone call from this driver. He goes, Johnny, one of my guys has showed up overweight. Do you want to come up now and compete in the U.S. four-man team trials? I said, well, when's the race? He goes, it's in 2 days. I said, 2 days? I've never pushed a bobsled in my life. He goes, all you have to do is get in the sled. I said, all right, true story. I fly into the Olympic Training Center the night before team trials. My first time ever on ice was at the U.S. four-man team trials, and we took third place. It was unbelievable. It was unexpected. See, when an unexpected opportunity showed up, I was ready. Now, I didn't know when it was going to come. I didn't know what it was going to look like. But when it showed up, I was ready. So let me ask you, if you're in the grit and things aren't going the way you anticipated, are you available for an unexpected opportunity? See, one of the things I battle with is pride. I always want to be right. Look at what I've accomplished. Look what I've done. Bobsled? Never even thought about it growing up. I can't take credit for it. Are you available for an unexpected opportunity. Because what happened now is I could dream big again. This set in motion a new dream, a four-year journey to make the United States Olympic team. And so I brought up one more short video I want to show you of us 1 week before the United States names the Olympic team. We're in one of my favorite spots, St. Moritz, Switzerland. You're going to see us going 85 miles an hour down this icy track, and we are currently in third place. And so as you watch this video, we are on the cusp of securing our spot. Here we are from Switzerland.
Bear with him. Nick Cunningham of the USA, what a great run from this man from Monterey, California in the first heat to put himself in medal contention with Justin Olsen, Johnny Quinn, and Dallas Robinson on the USA 2 sled.
This is another night train. This sled won with Holcomb last year at a bronze medal in this event. Cunningham started 16th, so he had that late start advantage. Good start, though. 5.07 start in the first run. 5.07 again. Speed in the left. 51.7 they should have. 51.7 they have. So now he's got to point it straight. And he's only got 14 trips or so in this sled. He only took it over at the Lake Placid World Cup and crashed it in Winterberg. And there's a big... Oh, it's over now.
Well, no. He's got a chance still.
That was a quarter. Speed. That was a quarter. 20 hundredths right there.
And it will continue to haunt him until he gets some speed out of Horseshoe.
Yeah, that mistake right there. If he has 110.5, he'll be lucky. 110.2 speed, yeah. That's all related to that mistake between Wall and Snake.
Best two results of the season in four man so far. Oh,
and then we crashed.
But he's gone.
We said that was giving everybody
80 miles
problems.
An hour on our heads.
Well, John, everybody.
He's in a sled with very different steering responses from what he's used to. And when the
our teammate falls out of the sled.
Instinct, it's leading him astray because it reacts differently from what he's been used to over the last few years with his older sled. And unfortunately, having to drop out the back, Dallas Robin.
And then we cross the line. Disqualified. Now, you guys know the end of the story. I became an Olympian for the United States. But at that point when we had a chance to secure our spot, we give it away? I've got another scripture we're going to look at, and if you've grown up in church, you've seen this before. You might even have it on a coffee cup. Very popular one, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. A future and a hope? We just crashed. Right? I've already been through this in my 20s when I was a professional football player. Are we not past this? See, when things get tough, when you're in the middle of a crash, it's tough to know that God has a future and a hope for you, isn't it? I wish I could say, I grabbed the guys and said, hey, guys, come here. Hey, the Lord has a future and a hope for us. No, it's not what I said. My prayers were, why? Help. Why now? Help. Why? Help. Have you prayed that prayer before? When you're in the middle of a crash, maybe your marriage is crashing. Maybe you've crashed with a child. Maybe something's happened at work. I want you to know that there's a reward, there's a hope and a future for you. There's a plan for your life. But it's tough to see when we're in the middle of the crash. You know, we checked the bobsled that needed to get fixed. Went and found my teammate. I said, hey, man, appreciate the extra leg room, but are you okay? How are you going 80 miles an hour? What are you doing back there? We got to go to Eagles, Austria, secure our spot on the Olympic team. We go to Austria the next week. We take fourth place and secure our spot. And to make that call home, to my wife, to my family, to my friends, to people who've supported me along the way. It was unbelievable because at 26 years old, my career was over, my dream done. But at age 30, when in the world of pro sports they call 30 old, to become a United States Olympian, it was unbelievable. To walk in opening ceremonies, to wear the red, white, and blue, it was so special. To be a small part of the 230 athlete delegation the United States sent to compete on a world stage, I can't put it into words. Here's the view that we saw when you walk in opening ceremonies, and then we sat down as Team USA, and you're looking out into the venue. If you can see the Olympic rings right here, that's where Vladimir Putin was sitting. Who thought we were going to talk about Putin in church today? Nobody. You know, I wish I could share with you the feeling of representing the United States on the greatest stage athletically. I can't put it into words, but I need you to know that the adrenaline is out the roof. And so the Olympics happen over 17 days. We get the schedule, wins the bobsled race. Day 16. So we're like, whoa, we got to cool this thing down a little bit. And so I remember, we walk in opening ceremonies, get there. Next day, I get stuck in my bathroom, and things went crazy. And so as we're, going to different venues, supporting other Team USA athletes, I remember doing an interview with the NFL Network. They wanted to do a piece on NFL players going to the Winter Olympics because now there's been three. And this reporter goes, hey, very candid. He goes, hey, Johnny, you played in the NFL, great, but you've never been to the Olympics. Are you going to be nervous? That was his question. And I said, you know what? You're right. I've never been to the Olympics. This is my first time in Russia. But what I need you to understand is that this time last year, this time 2 years ago when I was in McKinney, Texas, running around a middle school track where there were no camera crews, no fans, no Olympic stadiums, I already knew what this moment was going to be like. I already knew what the ice was going to smell like. I already knew what it was going to be like to get to that start block with my three other teammates, who we all have different personalities, different backgrounds, different belief systems, all coming together for one common goal. I already knew what that was gonna be like. Because of the story I've been telling. What story have you told yourself? Is your story even truthful? What if, during times of grit, we clung to God's story about you and me? What if we listened and clung to God's story about you? Jeremiah 1:5, I knew you before I formed you in the womb. Matthew 10:30, the very hairs on your head are all numbered. If you're bald in here, I'm sorry, you're out. Just kidding, that's a joke. Isaiah 43:1, I have called you by name. You are mine. What if we clung to that story about who you and I are in God's eyes when things get tough, when you're in the grit. You know, I've got a question I want us to consider as we wrap up. Where have you placed your identity? Is it in your career? Is it in another relationship? Is it somewhere else? Maybe you've yet to take that step to call Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior. Maybe today is your day. I hope it is. Where have you placed your identity? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for today, to gather here, Lord, and worship you. Lord, thank you for your grace and your mercy, and that when we are in the grit, we know that you have a plan, a future, and a hope for us, Lord. I pray that you will draw near. Lord, I pray for my friends here today who do not know you yet, Lord, that they will call you as Savior, that they will open their heart to you, Lord, and that you will work in us. In your Son's holy name we pray. Amen.